Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. For you guys that are listening at home, it's only been like 4 days, but for me, it's been a couple of weeks since I've done some recording. So if I'm a little bit rusty, you won't notice because I was not very good in the first place. But on this return episode for me, I am joined by the Natural 20. We're taking a gamble. We're rolling the dice. I don't know much about D&D, so I will have to ask questions about it. So I'm going to unsee my pants here with references. But it's Duke Cannon. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me. I'm really excited to be here. And this is my first ever podcast experience. So a little bit nervous and scary for me as well. But I'm looking forward to a nice little chat between us.
I'm sure it'll be fine. I think for a lot of wrestlers in Scotland now, I seem to be their first interview. So then they go and do other ones and they sound way more confident and like less scared of doing interviews. But like I said, between you and me, I'm terrified doing these as well. So like between us, we do try to fill out an hour or so of hopefully something interesting. Hopefully I ask things that are interesting, because if I don't ask the good questions, then what's my job here? I'm just looking like a pleb. Anyway, so the first question is always the same when we do these interviews for the first time and we get the first time guest on. I didn't say beforehand, you can swear, don't worry about it. Just don't go on a long
expletive. Thank fuck for that.
Just don't go on a long expletive rant. If you can avoid, I think I've kind of settled on maybe not the C word. That's about it, really. I think that's about it. But yeah,
that's good. I've just got a bad habit of like just swearing involuntarily. Like it comes up. I use swear words like most people use punctuation.
Well, it just rolls off our tongue because we're Scottish. It just kind of matches our accent quite nicely, regardless of what part of Scotland we're from. And I didn't say it beforehand, but yeah, that's another thing that I'll have a lot of people have their first interview with myself is they're terrified because the first like 50 or so episodes, it was no swearing. And I said, don't swear. And I think that just puts people on edge automatically when they're trying to answer questions, going, don't say fuck, don't say fuck, don't say fuck. But no, I'm just approaching 150 episodes now, so I don't give a fuck. Let's just swear all you want. Anyway, first question. We haven't even got to the first question yet. It's just a simple one. How'd you get into pro wrestling? What was the moment? What were you watching? What was the moment that got you hooked?
So when I was growing up, I watched a lot of wrestling. So when I was younger, went along to a lot of the kind of the dark days of British wrestling, as some people refer to, with your fake Undertakers, and I think we had a fake Road Warrior Animal as well. Although considering the timeline, it could have been the real Road Warrior Animal. I don't know.
With doggies on.
But yeah, so I kind of came away from it for a little bit. And it was when I came back down to uni, well, when I moved down to Dundee for university, and one of my flatmates was sat up, we're watching one of the WrestleManias, and, you know, I started sort of slowly getting back into it. I kind of got inspired to take up pro wrestling from two things. One was actually The Butcher in AEW. Before, you know, for anyone that doesn't know, before that, he was in a band called Every Time I Die, and they are like one of my favorite bands of all time. I've met Andy quite a few times just at gigs and things like that. Really lovely guy. And I just remember seeing him, you know, at this point, he'd been in the band for about 20 years. He was about in the sort of mid to late 30s and decided, I'm going to take up pro wrestling. And started doing it, and now he's working at AEW, and I was like, it was kind of one of those moments of like, if you can just have this sudden whim of like, you know, I can do this and go for it, was like, maybe I can do it as well. But I think the thing that really cemented it for me was, there's a YouTuber that I really like called Super Eye Patch Wolf, fantastic YouTuber. If you haven't watched any of his videos, I thoroughly recommend them. Back in 2018, he put out it was like an April Fool's video, because he mostly does like anime videos and things like that. It was sort of make people think of like, oh, what's this? It's coming on. But he sort of used that as an opportunity to actually go into his love of professional wrestling, and it really just invigorated something in me. And it just gave me this sort of like, you know what, I really want to give this a try. I really want to probably go forward with this and, you know, see if I'm capable of doing it. So I decided to start training at a Dundee-based company. And I am now working for FCW, been really happy there. Love all the guys that work there. I've been doing some work down in Arcadian, down sort of Newcastle way as well. Again, fantastic company, fantastic people down there. And I'm kind of just enjoying my little pro wrestling journey.
I like that you kind of you've kind of teased what we're going to speak about later on as well with the FCW and all that kind of stuff, because we will get into that a little bit in a bit. So I'm going to go right back to the start of all that, which was you started watching it. So was there any favourites? I mean, no, actually, I want to speak about the British wrestling stuff first, because I've had my experiences at those shows. So fake Undertaker. So what do you remember of these British shows, or is this just literally fake Undertaker and possibly maybe actually Road Warrior Animal?
Well, I always remember that, like, the opening match was always it was the Grim Reaper, which was just a guy in like a skeleton onesie, and then he would always face, like, it was either a Power Ranger or someone dressed as Spider-Man. And I always remember the Spider-Man coming out with, like, the cans of silly string, spraying it all over the audience and stuff, before taking into the ring from there. As well as, like, you know, there was obviously all your sort of fakes, you know, your the greatest hits of fakes, like your fake Doinks, your fake Undertakers, possibly real Road Warrior Animal. and all these. And but again, that was, like, my first sort of real experience. I grew up in a sort of small town in Aberdeenshire, so there wasn't like anything to really do up there. So when, you know, when the wrestling came to town, everyone came out for it. Everyone went to the town hall to see it. And, you know, I think we all knew it's just like, this isn't the real, you know, these aren't the real guys that are coming, but it's the spectacle of it all. It's the entertainment of it that drains people in. I mean, you can have as many fake Undertakers as you want, so long as the show's good. I think people will just be happy with that as well.
Not to be too nosy here, but I'm up in Murray. So we're about Aberdeenshire. Where are you?
I'm from Banff originally.
Ah, okay, cool. That's fine. I used to live in Newport Sligo, which was about...
Oh, not bad.
I stayed there for 2 years. That was enough. That was plenty for me. It was... I was like 18. I could drive. I barely stayed there, to be honest. But no, that's quite a small world when you mention that. So yeah, Banff, Spotty Bag Shop. There you go, plug. There you go.
It's like my one tradition whenever I go back home. It's straight to the Spotty Bag, seeing what new levels of tap they've got in there. Although the cafes went a little bit up in the world as well, so that's if you're ever back down, I do recommend popping in there for a coffee.
I've yet to find out, because one time we went up, it was closed. It was closed. It was still getting refurbed last time we went to Banff, and it was just. But I like Banff. I did my driving test there. And which was hilarious, because there's no roundabouts. There's a big car park, so I didn't have to do much bay parking, and it was just ace. And that probably explains why my driving is pretty terrible, because I didn't have to try in Banff that much. Yeah, so my experience of that is I saw Mankind in my youth, possibly maybe when I was like 10. The only thing I remember is him attacking an old man who kept jumping on the apron. So I don't know whether that was legit or not. So I'm still baffled 20 years later that I don't know if it was real. And I think I like that. As terms of wrestling, I like to just go, was that real or not? And then just have it haunt me for 20 years instead. So yeah, Banff. Oh well, that's a nice little connection we've got as we're starting off this chat. So was that just, were you just there in your youth, or was that until you moved down to for uni? Was it always, were you always up in the northeast?
Yeah, I mean, I lived there up until I was about 23. I moved down to Dundee in about 2014. After I originally went to college, studied some music, came down to study at Abertay to do creative sound production. I had my heart set on like working at Rockstar at one point, and then I spoke to people who work at Rockstar, and that swiftly turned me against the idea of working in the games industry.
So sound then. So is that it? Just like just musically working on the like, sound desks at gigs. What is that?
So creative sound production, it's sort of like the creation of sound, like music and sound effects and stuff for media. Everything from like movies and games and you know, like TV and things like that. How sounds implemented and the sort of different psychological aspects that you need to consider when you're putting sound effects into it and stuff. It was a really interesting course. And it was quite a lot of fun to do. But it was sort of one of those things where I think like I sort of just came out of college. I was kind of wanting to like move away from home, and it was one of those like, this would be a good idea to study this. And then not sort of thinking that the practical, it's kind of just jumping in. But it's I've worked on like a couple of small projects here or there, nothing major, mostly just like uni projects like games and animations and things like that. And I do like doing, I still like doing sound as like a more creative kind of creative thing. Like before taking up wrestling, I've done like live music for about the better part of about 10 years, playing in bands and putting on gigs and things like that, which was quite good for when I was coming into wrestling, because I at least had like the experience of being in front of an audience. I could at least comfortably be in front of people, because I think that can sometimes be the hardest thing to get over, is that kind of stage fright, you know, all eyes on you, just that any one moment. So it's been quite good to sort of like take elements from both and then mix them over into both to try and improve my live performance skills overall.
So with that kind of experience though, and that kind of mentality of like trying to create or use sound to elicit a reaction, how long did it take you to actually think of an entrance theme then? Was that kind of a difficult choice then, because you thought, oh, this can do this, this can do that, this can add to this character?
I'm legitimately, like, I still look through themes for, like, even my gimmick now. I'm still being like, this can maybe work a little bit better. Oh, but there's a good point that I can come through the curtain at this. And, like, I'm the most indecisive person when it comes to this. I've got, like, playlist upon playlist of just potential entrance themes that I'm probably never going to... With the amount that I've got in there, I'd be surprised if I could get through any of them, let alone them all. But yeah, I do like I do honestly just sit and just think constantly, just like, oh, this would be fantastic. Oh, this is going on the list. Oh, this would be good to maybe if I did this kind of gimmick. And it's, but I'm also like super indecisive, because I also come up with like 50 million gimmicks and can never decide on which one I want to stick with.
No, I'm having the same kind of conundrum at the moment, because I just finished watching Peacemaker, just rattled all the way through it. And every time that I'm going through a doorway now, I think I've got a wigwam, I do what I taste it in my head, because it was like just that moment where the dancing starts in the intro. For those that haven't watched Peacemaker, go watch it. It is interesting. I'll go interesting. It's definitely something to watch. And just when it kicks in, it's like through a doorway going, yes, just start doing the dance. But yeah, it's music. I guess a fun bit in wrestling in general is I think, I mean, you're actually getting to do the wrestling, but I think every fan really has a like that song, or has a couple songs. I think if one day, if I'm getting to go to the ring, this is the song I'm going to have. This is the one I want. And yeah, mine changes on a scary basis, but it's great.
Go ahead.
No, I was just gonna say I was doing a review of WrestleMania 22 for Eat Sleep Suplex Retweet, and the first thing I noticed was the music was just ace, because it started with Shinedown, I Dare You. That was the intro song, intro package, and I was like, oh man. And then I started going through all the songs from WrestleMania 22, 2005. So I was going through all the songs there. I had Monster Magnet for Matt Hardy's theme. Started making a playlist of all these songs, which I don't listen to generally. I'm like crap pop and musical kind. That's my kind of music playlist. And I was going through these songs going, oh, this is ace. I've got a bit of Papa Roach, got a bit of Nickelback, even though people don't like Nickelback, got a bit of Nickelback. All these songs when I was watching wrestling growing up going, this, or from the games as well, like... Therapy by Trapped? Is that song? Is it Trapped something? trapped by anyway. But yeah, there's so many good songs going on, and I suppose someone who's studied that kind of thing, yeah, I can see why it's a bit more difficult for you to kind of narrow it down to one, or at least try to.
Oh, I mean, like, if I could, I would pretty much just rinse through every song from, like, SmackDown versus Raw 2007 and just come out every show to just a different song from that soundtrack if I could get away with it.
Oh, that'd be amazing. So who were your favourites then growing up? Who were the ones that were like, this is my guy? This is the one that I'm rooting for?
I grew up in the Attitude Era, so there was always the love for, like, Steve Austin, The Rock. I think, like, growing up now and sort of looking back, I think my favourite's always really been probably Mankind or Mick Foley, just in general. Especially, like, I remember, like, my first proper pay-per-view that I can, like, remember watching was the Hell in a Cell, with, you know, the iconic one, him versus Undertaker, and just watching this man being thrown off of a roof and just being like, what is happening right now? And then seeing him, like, getting stretched out and then come straight back in, like, okay, this man's invincible. This man is incredible. What is going on right now? And I think, like, just the amount of dedication that he's put into the art of wrestling in general, like, he's, you know, growing up, I was, like, I'm always a bit of a bigger kid as well, so, like, yeah, we'd see, like, guys like Steve Austin, I'm not going to be like them, but Mick Foley coming down, you know, a guy who's, like, a little bit heavier and stuff, and, like, this, you know, this is a guy for me, this is a guy that shows that I can do this as well, this is a guy who is maybe not the greatest wrestler, but he is so tough, he is willing to give every single thing that he is and has to his craft. And even when I was younger, I could kind of recognize that as well, and just being like, this guy is, you know, this guy's real, this is the reason why wrestling is real, because this guy can just take everything and just keep on coming at it.
Absolutely. I mean, my first Mick Foley experience was WrestleMania 15, which I don't care what anyone says, I love WrestleMania 15, and it was Big Show versus Mankind, and then Big Show had Mankind on his back, yeah, and they just dropped back. So this is, I mean, he wasn't 500 pounds at that point, but he was near as damn it to that point. Yeah. And then an hour later, he was out for the main event to batter, I don't know, Big Show or The Rock or Vince McMahon, to batter somebody. And it was like, this guy's a bit weird and a bit nuts, and he's got the wee spray painted striped shirt for being a referee. And yeah, it was just, you're right, it just had that passion. You could tell he was just enjoying being there and being a wrestler, which people can tell. You can tell if you're not enjoying wrestling, if you see a wrestler not enjoying themselves, you know that.
Yeah.
So it's important mentally to be that excited for wrestling. So Attitude Era then. So who's your kind of boys then? Who's your like ones that you maybe didn't want to admit at the time, like an S.A. Rios or a Grandmaster Sexy, or who's your kind of lower card guy?
I know, I mean, like, I'd struggle to call them lower card because of just how over they were, but just too cool in general. Mm. Like, I love them so much. Like, Scott, the amount of times that I tried to do the worm was unreal. I would watch it, I'd watch Scotty Too Hot to do it, I'd be able to do the hops, and then I'd just go down and just couldn't get back up again. And I was like, okay, I'm just gonna have to accept that this move is escaping me now. But I think, again, that was, that was some performers that were like, you can, every time that they came out, you can tell that they were just enjoying themselves. You can tell that they were happy to be in the ring, never phoning it in. And every time that, you know, every time they would go put on the shades, lights go down, it was magic. It was just incredible to watch. And I think that's something that can sometimes be missing from wrestling. You know, people can take it a bit too seriously at times as well. I mean, like, by all means, we should always take our craft seriously. But you can take your, like, what you do seriously without taking yourself seriously as well. And I think that really comes across when you go out there and when you're willing to just have fun and, you know, put the audience's, like, entertainment, like, first and foremost.
I mean, the people that are coming to the shows, they might not know the difference between a wristlock and a wristwatch, but they're coming to be entertained for 2 hours or 3 hours or however long they're there. And I mean, there is companies out there that are just dedicated to that wrestling crowd that want to do all the fancy moves and the crisscrosses and flippy doodles. But when it comes to actually a family friendly experience, which is probably the majority of places you've been at the moment, they're coming maybe 2 adults, 5 kids that are coming. I know what Dundee's like, but so they're coming with two adults, and the adults are there just to pay in. They're not really going to be there to watch the wrestling, but if you can entertain them, then you're on to a winner, because they'll come back next time. They'll come back the time after. So
exactly, yeah. I mean, I've always had that sort of mentality with doing live music as well. Is that, you know, the people who turn up, you know, the people who turn up to the gigs on a regular basis, you know, they love gigs. They do it because they enjoy it. It's the same with wrestling. The people who turn up to the wrestling all the time, they love wrestling. They will be there. But if you can take that person who's kind of been dragged along and make them interested, then you know that you've done your job right.
Absolutely. So when you finally made your way to training, which I assume is an interesting experience for where you started, but as I said, codename Dundee. So what was like your first experience then in the ring? Just finding out what it's like itself.
I don't think I realized of like how physically taxing it would be. I mean, I at the point that I did it, I was probably like in probably what I would say the best shape that I'd been at that point. So I was thinking, okay, you know, it'll be pretty good. And yeah, I didn't have the illusion that it was going to be easy by any stretch of the word. But then going in and even just like learning how to take a bump, because it's such an unnatural movement. Like, you're just flinging yourself backwards and like trying to not give yourself a concussion on the way down. And just like, even just trying to get used to that was like, it was such a weird experience. Cause I think that's the thing with wrestling, is that your body does so many things that it's not naturally meant to do. And it's trying to train both your body and your mind to do these things like with confidence. So like, luckily enough, when we came in, you know, we did start off with that. It was all basics, you know, just your bumps, your chain, your rolls. When I was all a bit younger, I did some gymnastics. My dad was still is a gymnastics coach. So a lot of the stuff like rolls and things like that were not, you know, it wasn't a million miles away from me. But I think getting used to, yeah, those, like the proper aspects of wrestling, like your bumps, your chain, and even just running the ropes, like trying to, you know, having to think about the rhythm as you're sort of, you know, as you're going against ropes and things like that. It was a little bit, I wouldn't say overwhelming, but yeah, I did feel a little bit out of my depth. But fortunately, you know, despite everything that has happened at Redacted Name Dundee Company, I also met some just incredible people who I'm still friends with to this day. A lot of them came over to FCW with us, and you know, we've always supported each other, helped each other, and just made sure that we are trying to be as best as we can at the sport that we love.
I think that's the thing, especially if I mean, someone who's done gigs and that are a bit more extroverted, they'll just make friends kind of thing. So that's always a good thing. But I always like hearing going to these schools, and because at the end of the day, you've got to trust the people that you're in with as well, because they've got your body. They're in charge of you for even a split second, and if they're not confident or not in charge, things just go wrong entirely. I assume this is all stuff that I'm just picking up secondhand, because my in-ring career lasted about 5 minutes when I rolled into a ring, announced the match, and then left the ring. that was enough. That was plenty. Conveniently enough, at Name Redacted Company in Dundee, so that was my appearance. Wearing an ill-fitting shirt and shoes that I broke the sole of that morning, and yeah, I fit in quite nicely. So from that point on, but how long was it before you actually got in the ring, got in, like made your debut in front of a crowd?
So it did take a while for me to sort of get into the ring. partly because I was sort of going through quite a few mental health problems at the time. I had quite a lot of anxiety. I was going through quite a few depressive stages, so that to the point of I would come to training and there'd be times when I'd be messing up like a simple move, which is, it's what happens. You sometimes just have your brain farts. Those days where the thing that you've done countless times before, you forget how to do. And then, I'd take it like really harshly and I'd be, I'd take it out of myself and things. And I didn't want to go into the ring until that was at least clear enough that I know that I'm not going to like have a breakdown mid-match or anything like that. The other part of it is also because Name Redacted Dundee Company tends to like to put certain people in the ring, and people that are his boys, let's say. So when I first got into the ring, we had a student showcase. And it was my sort of head coach, Kevin Williams, who put me forward for it. It was against Dean Ambrose, and I was instantly just like, wait, what? I was super excited, but I was just like, I think I'm out my element here. He's like up here. I'm just this little trainee guy. He told me. I told me about that, and we went through the match, and it was probably, I don't think anyone likes their first match, same as no one would like their first gig or their first book or something like that. But coming out of it, like, Ian was a consummate professional. He's fantastic. Saved a spot that I kind of messed up. So there was a spot that I was supposed to do where I was going to do a cartwheel into a clothesline. And again, doing gymnastics when I was younger, I've done cartwheels since I was since about five. Apart from this one time that I cannot knock out a cartwheel and I just completely fob it up. And Ian just saves it because it's just like, with no hesitation, he just lariates me straight to fucking hell. As soon as I stand back up, he was just like, nope, down you go. But that was a lot of good. It helped build a lot of confidence in me as well. Because I'll admit, I'm not the greatest wrestler on earth. I mean, I can work in front of a crowd. I'm more than happy sort of shouting and interacting and stuff. And Ian was really good for sort of putting a lot of things in perspective. He says that some advice that he gave me was that if you have a sort of character and you have personality, everything else can kind of follow on from there. And you can get away with maybe using a bit more sort of basic moves and things like that, so long as you've got something that people can kind of latch on to. One of my proudest moments in that match is that was my first in-ring appearance, and I shut down a what chant.
How did you do it? What was the secret?
Okay, So the whole setup was that, I was coming out and I was indignant because I didn't get a match. The whole, like, Ian coming out was like, it wasn't advertised, it was like a secret thing. So I come out and I'm like, I feel so indignant because I was playing heel at the time. I feel so indignant that I have not been given a match because I'm so great and all that. And the crowd start going, what, what, what? And I just turned around and said, I said the exact same thing. What, what? How can this be? How could anyone look over me for this match? And I remember, like, when we're watching the match back in training the next day, Kevin paused it. He just says, that is how you react to a watch on. And I, like, it gave me so much hope. And then it went on to fuck up the cartwheel, so it's all ebbs, it's all like peaks and troughs, I guess.
Go back a little bit then. It's good that you're able to kind of recognize that you weren't ready to be in the ring, or at least you can trust yourself. So why should you expect someone to trust you in the ring? Which is always a good thing, because I've watched wrestling long enough now to see some people that maybe shouldn't have been in there at the time, kind of thing. It's just one of those things that happens. So it's always good when you can recognize yourself that it's like, no, that this is not for me right this second. Give me a bit more time, kind of thing. But when you had that first match then, other than the fuck up cartwheel, was that your kind of confidence boost going, right, I've got one in, I'm ready to get a few more matches in there.
Yeah, I think that was definitely the case, because I think getting that first one out of the way is just, it is the hardest one, because you build it up so much in your head, especially if it's like a completely new experience that you've never done before. And it's like, it's kind of like ripping off the plaster. Like, you just go out there, doesn't matter whether it's fantastic or not. The fact of the matter is you get it out, you know, you've got it out of the way. You've got that first one, and then you can always go from there. And another piece of advice that Ian gave me was that you're only as good as your last match. So, you know, if I left that single match where I fuck up the cartwheel and stuff like that, is the only match that I do, that doesn't leave a good legacy or anything. So I'm like, okay, so I can at least strive to improve from there, so that at the very least, if I do ever have a last match, I can look back and be like, no, that was good. That was worth like showing to people.
So I mean, I would have had loads of notes and stuff for your time from 2019 to FCW. However, I removed them from my website, so I don't have the information, and I'm the only place that seems to would have had it. So I don't have any notes of matches or anything like that, unfortunately. So hopefully you'll be providing some information. But one note that I did have was a tweet you put out. It was just, I think it might have been, I don't know, Dickie Divers or somebody put out like a nightmare of your music hitting and you still haven't released up your boots. And yours was, you were listing up your boots and you're for your second appearance of the evening. So just out of curiosity from that, were you in Yuji Maki's school of rejected luchadors?
I was not in the school for luchas, but I did wear a mask, if that might clue a little bit. I don't know. I mean, I definitely not. I wasn't part of the school for luchadors, but I did definitely have a masked gimmick, and you know, I went out. I went out during a rumble for my first appearance, in my first gimmick, which was the masked one. Went out, did the spot, came back, and then it was just go go go. Me and my tag partner, like we've gotten like kind of undressing each other down to a fine art to get into, because we were always peeling double duty. So it was just like, okay, like let's get down into the next gear, let's go. As I was like literally lacing up my boots for my second appearance, and my music hit, and I don't think I've ever moved so quickly in my life. Like, I went from the chair that I was on to just out of the curtain within like nanoseconds. it was a very terrifying experience.
I like wrestling a mask thing, because of course that's not your full-time gig, wrestling in a mask. You see guys like your Lucha DS's and your Talon Juniors and that have, and Spike Tierney, that wrestle in the mask for the whole time. Was that a learning experience dealing with that kind of loss of peripheral vision, that you're kind of a little bit loss of hearing as well? What was it like wrestling a mask?
I think wrestling the mask for me, it was more learning about the physicality of it, because you can't rely on facial expressions, because you know you're fully covered up. So it really helped me sort of learn how to sell a lot more of, like, you know, you have to be big and theatrical so that people can sort of tell what's happening. You can tell what emotions you're trying to convey at the time. If you're getting beat up and you know you're scared of the, you know, you're scared of the person who's just kicking the shit out of you, you know, you have to like really convey that and really show. I mean, I was still like very vocal underneath the mask as well, despite my terrible accent.
I think I figured out the theme. That's fine. Right, you're cutting now. That's your second payday is gone now. If I'm thinking it's the right team,
due to current events, there has been some revelations where certain things have had to be retired.
I think if anyone's listening, you'll know. You're just fine. You'll get it. yeah, it was clicking as soon as you said tag team. I was like, I think of a tag team. And yeah, we got there. So yeah, so that was that. And then of course you had some time in Dundee and Name Redacted. And so my first note really is just like the start of the year. So I'm lost a lot of info. I've lost like 2 years. I mean, the pandemic kind of took some of that time away. But So you were having your matches. Pandemic hit. So that was March 2020. So you kind of just started, and then you've had to stop entirely. What was it like when the pandemic hit for you? Were you able to kind of do what you usually did and being a student, or was it all just like Zoom stuff? Was it this Zoom stuff again? What was your kind of experience with that?
So when the pandemic hit, it was I know it was really weird because I'm the kind of guy who's like I'm out the house 24/7. Like I use my flat to eat and sleep, and then I'm straight back out again. So when the lockdown hit and it was just you're staying inside for the foreseeable future, better get used to it quickly. I was just like, okay, this is weird, this is strange. And especially because I hadn't really been in wrestling for that long. So it was that kind of like, okay, is this like, you know, when's this going to pick up again? Am I going to have to start from square one? What can I do in the meantime to try and keep things going? So, you know, I tried my best to start keep on top of like fitness and things like that. You know, since I wasn't anything, you know, since I was used to being out the house a lot, I was going out for jogs most nights and things like that. I did tune into a few of Looking Sharp's seminars that he did. Some of them were just absolutely fantastic. I got a chance to take part in the Mikey Whipwreck one, which was really interesting, as well as the one for Connor from Ascension. That was really good. And again, it was good to get that like other people's perspectives as well. And I spent a lot of time sort of studying that aspect of wrestling. Because it was like, you know, if I can't be in a ring, if I can't do moves and things like that, let's think about things like psychology. Let's think about whether my, you know, this gimmick is going to fully work, or if I've got, you know, if I do have everything as fine-tuned as I can, and try to think of all the other aspects that I was maybe thinking I was like overlooking, you know, focusing too much on like, oh, just get all the, you know, get all the moves right and do all this and try and be all super flippy and everything. Like I can't be flippy. My feet don't leave the ground nowadays. I'm 30 now.
That's fine. I'm with you. I'm 30, 31. That's where I am at the moment. And my knees feel a bit 60. So I went into one of the Looking Sharp things. It was the Krieger one. It was the one that I checked out, and it was just because it was, well, one, because it was free. And because I thought, if I pay £10, I don't know what I'm going to get from it, seeing as I'm not actually doing the wrestling. But the Krieger one was free, and I came out of it going, oh my God, I've actually learned a lot about tag team wrestling from this that I didn't think I was going to come out with, because I thought I was just going to sit back and go, this doesn't apply to me. But now I can watch matches differently. Did you find yourself like finding like older matches you may have not watched in your youth or growing up that you went back and, or was there any wrestlers that you were kind of told to maybe check out that would help with working out what you want to do?
So when it comes to sort of looking back on things, I think like, especially kind of just getting into wrestling in general gave me a whole other appreciation for it as well. Because even if, I feel that like, even if you are sort of like a fan and you sort of know how things work, it's different from when you actually experience these things as well. You know, when you take that bump and when you realize how hard a ring can be, it really sort of put things a little bit more into perspective. So any sort of match that I've went back and rewatched has given me like a sort of an overall new perspective for it. I was a little bit like yourself, like you mentioned, Krieger and the sort of new appreciation for tag team wrestling. It was the same for the Connor seminar for us. Of course, since he was in Ascension, when he was with WWE, me and my tag partner, we jumped in because we're like, you know, this is going to be fantastic. He's going to have like a wealth of knowledge, and he did. He told us, you know, even just little things such as like how when you know when they're in the when the ring, they have like the sort of different, you know, they have like their different, what's the word? Different roles in the ring. You know, you've got Connor being the big guy, being, as he described it, the hammer that like beats them down, and other, I've forgotten the other one's name. I feel terrible.
Victor.
Victor, that's the one. Yeah, so like Victor was as described as the knife that cuts them out from underneath them,
like a sickle,
or like a sickle. Yeah,
yeah.
We made that exact same connotation. Weird that.
so you're there with your partner then, just kind of go, what's my role, what's your role, kind of thing from that.
But I think what's our role, and how do we come together as a team, how do we work as a cohesive unit? Like at the moment I'm in a tag team with Nathan North at FCW. Fantastic guy, love working with him. And like the story that we've got at the moment is that, you know, we're coming together as a team, like we're learning how to work with each other. We had, I think it was back in January, we had a match against Foundation of the Future, Zach Dynamite and Ryan Riley. Probably one of my favourite matches that I've had. They're just fantastic to work with. I can't sing their praises enough. But even sort of like seeing how they work in the ring as a cohesive unit, like when they hit the ring, you can tell that these guys are a well-oiled machine. These guys are a team, and sort of understanding how to work with another person and not just seem like two individual wrestlers that have just kind of been mashed together. It can be quite hard to sort of get adjusted to it, but. That's one of the things that I really liked about the corner seminar, is that it would put a lot of those kind of things into perspective and really gave me like a much bigger appreciation for tag team wrestling as well. Whereas like I might not have had that before, you know, there is that sort of thing of, especially like when you watch WWE, there was the longest time that tag matches just didn't really matter within the company. And I think there is a bit of a fallout from that as well. Some people can see tag matches just like, oh, that's a, you know, it's just like this a slog, or oh, I'm not really interested, I want to see all the other things. But like, you have a lot of potential for that as well, because you've got like four, you're two different teams, four guys, all with different dynamics, and if you can bounce well off of each other, then you can go out there and create some absolute magic.
Absolutely, yeah, I couldn't agree more. And when you mentioned that match with Foundation of the Future, of course, big fan of Foundation of the Future, being from up here. I was hearing so many good things about the match afterwards, and to the point where I did the match of the month thing for January, and I had so many comments going, you haven't put this match in, this match has to be in, this match has to be. And it was you, yourself and Nathan North against Foundation of the Future. I was just inundated with just being told I was wrong, pretty much, that I had to have this match in there. Was it a bit weird when you, how much experience did you have with Nathan North beforehand? Because of course Nathan North is from up in Viruti way, so it's not a stone's throw away from Banff, but it's pretty close. So you're kind of from the same area, and now they're down in Perth area, Perthshire, and that teaming up as a team. How weird was that?
it was a little bit weird, because I think when I first started, like I basically got told by Kev, I was just like, hey, I'm looking to put together a tag team. I think like since Nathan does the, you know, the gamer gimmick, we've got you doing the Dungeons and Dragons thing, I think you could work well together. So I was like, yeah, let's go for it. I'm a try anything once kind of guy, just like, hey, let's give it a try, see if it works. And so meeting up, I'm not gonna lie, I didn't realise he was up. I knew that he did like work at WrestleZone and stuff. I didn't realise he lived like near Inverurie.
I think so. I've interviewed him in the past, so if you want to check that archives, you can find it. But I'm sure he's up in Viruti way. That he was definitely Aberdeenshire. So it's like, it's just a weird coincidence when now that I found out that you're from Aberdeenshire, that yeah, you've ended up totally different journeys, but have ended up teaming together from the same neck of the woods.
I think it's a, I think it's more just the fact that like people from Aberdeenshire are like rats. You're never more than 6 feet away from one.
You're not wrong. it's weird. It's like living in Elgin. Every time you go somewhere, we were like down in Glasgow not long ago, Aberdeen. You always end up meeting someone in Elgin from Aye. Elgin, but Glasgow, we end up wandering, and my wife and I'm going, oh, I do whatever. I went to an exercise class with that person. Oh, they're from Elgin. Like, how? Go away. I want to get away from this place for a weekend. Just no. I don't want anyone from here to be down here at the same time. But it's just weird things.
Oh yeah, the weirdest one that I had was I used to, like, during the pandemic, I was working at Tesco call centre, doing like the grocery home shop and stuff. And there was one day that I got a phone call from a lady. I think she was down in like Gloucester or something by the postcode. And you know, we just started talking things like that. And she says, "Oh, just out of curiosity," and she had like a bit of a like an English twang, but you know, maybe something like. Like soft enough that you realise that she's not maybe from there. And she says, "Oh, can I just ask, are you from Scotland?" And I was like, "Yeah, I'm from Scotland." And she says, "If you don't mind me asking, where about in Scotland are you from?" And I says, "Well, yeah, I'm living in Dundee, and but I'm originally from Banff." And then she goes, "Oh, I grew up in White Hills." And I'm like, "Shut up. No, you didn't." And she was just like, I instantly recognised the accent. And I'm like, "God damn it."
For those that are aware, White Hills is about, I'd say, half an hour from Banff, if that, depending on how fast you
are. Like, it's not even that. It's like, you can probably, like, you can walk there in about, like, 10 minutes or something. Like,
I know, I mix it up with the other. No, Cullen screws me up with when I'm driving, and I always forget where it is. So, yeah, that'll be... But, yeah, it's very close, pretty much. It's very close to all that area. And, yeah, it's so weird that we're in such a small, secluded northeast bit, but yeah, we are like rats. You'll always find someone that's from the area somehow. It's either Elgin or Burghead. It's always bloody Burghead, and they don't move. Once you're in Burghead, you don't get out, and yet they still find them in all these places. there was the tangent for the evening, right? So the pandemic, that's where we were. Of course, then stuff came out middle of the year of 2020 that kind of, some not surprising, some surprising, some rumblings and rumours, what have you, of many companies and wrestlers and what have you. It was crap. It was a shit time. But the company, Redacted company, that we have not named so far, and we will try to keep that going. A lot of stuff came out about them. Whether true or not, I'm not one to say. I don't know. I wasn't there. But, of course, then what was your thoughts when all that kind of stuff came out? Were you thought, oh, that's it? I've got nowhere else to train. I've got nowhere else to go. What was your kind of initial thoughts when the mass exodus of folk leaving happened?
So by the time that was happening, I was kind of flirting with the idea of leaving the company anyway. I wasn't 100% sure of where, you know, I still wanted to be in wrestling. I still wanted to give it a try. But I wasn't 100% sure what to do, but I just knew that I didn't want to be with them. But I was also in that sort of camp of like, you know what, I've got a lot of friends here. There's a lot of guys that I care about. I'm going to miss seeing them every day. So, you know, we'll just sort of, pardon me. We'll just sort of go forward from there and, you know, see what happens. And I saw like the first bit of news of one of our, you know, one woman wrestlers who was working for the company and an experience that she had with someone who also worked at the company that there was actually rumours about before. And then I was just like, I'm done. I'm out. Like, as soon as that came up, I was just like, I'm done. I was with a couple of friends at the time, you know, people who were with Redacted Company as well, so we were just like, you know what, we're like, I'm done. I don't know about you guys, you're adults, you can do whatever you want, I'm not abiding by this. I even remember sending a message to head of said company, and I think it went along the lines of, I'm leaving. You know exactly why. Fuckity bye, and then block them.
That must make a nice change that you're blocking him and he wasn't blocking everyone.
Well, he did. He decided to remove a couple of people from the training page because he was thinking that he had it in his head that people were leaking stuff out. And he got on his head without even like speaking to me or anything. I've been removed from it. And then I was just like, you know what? I'm not putting up with this guy anymore. I'm better than that. I deserve better than that. Everybody in this company deserves better than that. I'm going to take the first step and then leave. And then we spoke to, all the people who were leaving. We were like, well, by that point, FCW had like started, they'd run a couple of shows. So I remember saying to like Kevin John, I was like, you know what? I'm here at the ends of the earth for you. Like, you guys are good. You guys have always done well by us. You're creating something good here. So I'm going to follow you guys, whether you want me to or not. And I'm going to make sure that this is a success and show what wrestling can actually be. Especially with the idea of coming back into Dundee at some point and, you know, putting on some really good wrestling, putting on some really good shows and making sure that we can create a really good environment in wrestling as well, which I think is like one of the most important things, especially with a lot of the thing, you know, a lot of the just abhorrent fucking shit that came out during that entire time, just reading about what people went through, it was heartbreaking. And I think, like, you know, going forward from there, I have seen concerted efforts from people to make that safe environment and to make that, you know, that good, a good place where people can feel properly comfortable. I think the FCW has done a really good job. As I said, I was working with Arcadian just this weekend past, and they've created that environment as well. You go in there, everybody, it's like you go down and like you're meeting your friends again for the first time in ages, even if you've never met them before. Everyone's so welcoming, everyone's so lovely. And again, it's good to actually see that level of care being taken into wrestling nowadays as well.
I mean, of course, some of these companies, name redacted companies, still operating, and it's one of those things where, from my standpoint, is I've taken off like the stuff from these companies. Some of these companies I won't post about for whatever reason. But if people still want to work for them, like you're saying, they're adults. They've made their decision, and if they trust the people in charge, whether they did these things or not, again, these are all allegations and what have you, then it's up to them. I won't cover it. That's pretty much my kind of standpoint on it, which, you know, means nothing to a lot of people. Yeah. Because I'm just a guy with a blog who bought a domain name. That's pretty much it. And if folk don't want my stuff, don't want me to put it on my site, then cares at the end. It's you know, wrestling, I have to say, wrestling's kid on. So just, I mean, you got to enjoy it. If you don't enjoy it, then don't do it, kind of thing.
Yeah.
Anyway, that was the next tangent of me, just existential crisis of should I cover one company or not? FCW, of course, they started Training Academy. Was it just in the rumblings before pre-pandemic, or was it just afterwards? Because I know it was quite late on when I started hearing about it. So. It was just when the stuff was opening up again, they started their training academy. So was there any people that in your friends that came over initially, or was there people that you got to meet through that was like kindred spirits? What was it like getting in a new training environment?
I mean, it was quite good going over to FCW because there was a lot of guys that came over that I already knew and liked and respected, guys like Bochico, guys like Sebastian Asher, Jay Robin, they all started coming. You know, we all sort of made that path of like, you know what, we're not putting up with Name Redacted anymore. We want to go and create something new and fantastic. So we went there. I also got to meet like a lot of new people as well, and it was weird also being in the position of like, being the slightly more experienced guy and someone's coming in sort of like pretty fresh off. There was also like some other guys that sort of came over who initially maybe started off at Name Redacted and just had a terrible experience. It was like, I don't want to be here. But as soon as they came over to FCW, they were like, oh no, this is what wrestling's supposed to be like. This is actually fun. This is actually enjoyable. So it was fantastic to, I think, see that growth in other people as well. And see them, you know, see them come into this environment and be like, look, the things that you've experienced so far is not indicative to the entire of the industry. You know, there is great people in here. There is great environments. And, you know, we will show you that. We will show you that this is an industry worth getting into.
So as far as of course, I mean, your matches, we've got matches in Tayport. Was that your first like solo outing in FCW? That triple threat with Mackie and Tom Fulton. So what was it like in without a tag team partner kind of thing? What was that like for you, especially a new town like Tayport for FCW?
So it was breaking up a little bit on my side there. Was that the last FCW show this was passed?
That was the 29th of January. So it was the night after. It was Tayport, the debut in Tayport for FCW. It was a triple threat with Mackie and Fulton.
Ah, right, yeah.
So I was asking, is that your first kind of solo outing in FCW, or did you do anything pre-pandemic with them?
So that was my first solo outing. As a sort of like, I mean, obviously it wasn't a singles match, you know, it was a triple threat. So that was my sort of first outing, just kind of as myself, in like a sort of full match. And I won't lie, that was like a little bit nerve-wracking, but luckily I was in with Ewan G. Mackie and Tom Fulton, who are just two of just the best wrestlers that I've seen. And I, you know, having the pleasure to work with them was fantastic. You know, they kept me right, they kept me safe. I was working with an injury at the time as well. Like, I had a bit of a problem with like around my sort of chest area. So they took that in consideration as well, and you know, sort of like kept me safe and kept everything sort of going. And it was really good to, I think it was really good to just be in in that environment with like people that you can trust. It's like, I'm going into this room with like two guys who completely know what they're doing, but also two guys who are focused on putting on a great show. Two guys who are focused on, let's make sure that the audience is coming away with a fantastic experience here. And so getting to work then was an absolute honor. And it was pretty nerve-wracking, but it was good to, I think it was good to sort of build up my confidence as like a singles wrestler as well. Not like, again, like, I don't want to be sort of too complete. I'd like to be like enough of a workhorse that I can, you know, jump into anything that I'm asked to if needed. So any opportunity I can get to try and at least get a little bit better would be fantastic. I did have prior to doing the stuff with FCW, I worked Arcadian back in October, which was a singles match as well. That was terrifying because that was like my first proper match back. And I'm just like, this is scary. This is terrifying. But again, I was working with a guy called Persona. It was kind of weird. He was a lot younger than me, but he'd wrestled for a lot longer than I had. So it was weird having that kind of dynamic. But again, he was fantastic. He sort of kept us all right, kept us safe. And I think a lot of it is just kind of like just making sure that you're just building up your confidence as you go and trying to get as much skills, trying to learn as much. When you're in the ring, as much as like you're trying to like do the things, I think there was one thing that I saw. I think it was an interview with Joe Hendry that described it really best when he says that everyone's got a 2-to-1 ratio of 2 ears to 1 mouth, so you should always be quiet and listen. And I think that even being in like a match is like that as well. It's if you have an opportunity to learn something, even if it's just like learn something that you do that you can maybe improve upon or change, then that's, you know, that's a fantastic experience. Even if the match goes horribly wrong, if you can take that out of it, it's at least been a worthwhile experience as well.
The one bit that just pricked my ears up there was, I said you went into that triple threat carrying an injury, and I suppose back in ye olde days, you would just kind of walk off and not tell anyone. But you're in an environment where you can just take Mackie and Fulton aside and go, look, I've got a bit of a knock. Just keep aware of that, just in case that they have any like things planned where you need to do military presses to everyone where you're trying to expand the diaphragm a bit more than you usually would. So it's always a good environment where you're able to do that. You're able to speak up and go, look, I'll be fine, but just remember this is happening. This is a thing that's there. I don't know if that was a thing in your in Name Redacted, whether it was just a walk off mentality if you were injured. Oh well, here's your coppers, enjoy kind of thing. but no, that's the thing that just caught my ear there. So Arcadian then. We'll go to Arcadian. You've mentioned them a couple of times. You said you worked for them October in one of your first matches back. What was it like getting like a over the border booking? So it would be outside of Scotland for the first time and wrestling in front of an English crowd. What was it like getting that message?
It was surprising, I'll say that much, because especially up at that point, I didn't have like a lot of matches under my belt. I hadn't done an awful lot in the ring. So when it was Kevin Williams who sort of arranged everything and said, hey, we're going to take a couple of people down. We're doing like a sort of talent share thing, bring them up, we'll go down, sort of work that way. And when he selected me, I was just like, really? Like, there's 100 better guys out there that you can take down. Why are you taking me? But, you know, he trusted me enough to do it. But I think it's also, like, I quite enjoyed it more for the fact of I was going in front of a completely unknown crowd. Like, there was no one in that crowd who sort of knew me either as Duke Cannon or sort of outside of wrestling either, so that at least if I'm going in front of that crowd and I can get a reaction, I know that it's a genuine one. I know that it's not like, you know, just like friends who are turning up and just sort of like being supportive. I don't know, I appreciate that, don't get me wrong, but it's not just people who are just being supportive. It's if I'm getting a reaction out there, it's because something's actually working, because it's like, I think that you can sometimes get like a bit too comfortable if you're in front of the same people all the time and all that, and sort of just accept that as a sense of like, oh, well, I'm doing good because all these people are cheering at me. But I think like making sure that you're in front of that unfamiliar audience and getting those, getting those sort of different reactions is important as well. It's, again, that's something I've kind of carried over from music. Of like, you know, when your friends come down to a gig and stuff like that and they cheer and say, oh, your band's fantastic, all yous were great. You've always got that in the back of your mind of just like, yeah, but how much are you just saying that because we're just friends? Whereas if you go to a completely different town, you play in front of completely new people and they come up and say, oh, your band's fantastic, I really like you guys. You know, they don't have an obligation to come up and sort of like stroke your ego or make you feel any better, so that it makes you at least know that you're doing a good job in some capacity.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, yeah, if it's your pals, they're here for the free ticket. So then they're going to turn around and go, yeah, you're a bit crap tonight, aren't you? Because next time you're going, well, I don't want them there. So they have to pay for a ticket to get in next time. So that was Arcadian. Of course, the match I've got, most recent one then, is 25th of March, just this past weekend, was against Joe Briggs. Assuming it happened. Because Arcadian's not great with updating their social media. I'm just putting that out there for them. So I assume the match happened. And that's a very experienced opponent to go up against. Of course, he wrestles all over England and up in Target as well when they cross the border. So what's it like going in the ring with someone of the wealth of experience of Joe Briggs?
Honest to God, if I could work with Joe all the time, I would. It was such a good match, especially considering that like we were kind of held up coming down, like, you know, coming down from Dundee in the car, and we just hit. You were just behind every slow driver, like every person who decided, I'm just going to go at 30 today. So we were getting in a little bit late, and you know, there was a bit of that anxiety as well, just like, oh, we don't have that long to plan the match. Because I think we got in like half an hour before doors were going to open. And I was instantly just sort of like, okay, where's Joe? Let's speak. Let's get this all sort of planned out. And honestly, it was so easy. We went in, we talked about it, we got it planned in about 10 minutes. And it was like, I was confident with it as well. Again, because I'm usually like still a little bit unsure, you know, I'm a little bit less experienced. So when we went into the ring and just started working, and the crowd were just so into every bit of it as well. Like they were there in the palm of our hand. And I think that was a great thing as well, as like working with someone who is, again, definitely experienced in being in front of people, being in front of the ring, but just somebody who kind of gets the business as well, and somebody who's wanting to just put on the best show possible. And I think we did. That's one of the best matches that I would say that I've had. And I'm usually quite bad for coming back through the curtain and just being like, oh, I could have done this better. Oh, this, you know, just like going into my own head and just thinking of like, oh, like I could have improved this, this and this. But I came back from that curtain. I was just like, you know what? There's definitely things I need to improve upon, but that was a fantastic match. That was a good, solid match. And again, if I could work with Biggs every other day, I would. Because he is utterly fantastic. He is just such he's such a good worker. Just, you know, there's no ego there. There's no like, oh, I've got to get all my shit in, I've got to do all this. It's just like, you know, let's go out and put on a good damn show and make some people happy.
It's always the best way. Right. So other than your kind of run-ins with Red Gate, we've kind of covered your wrestling career a little bit there. Dungeons and Dragons then. So what I've found during these interviews, which we've done so many now, there's a lot of wrestlers that are big into Dungeons and Dragons. I don't know if it's just because the fantasy, the creativity, I don't know what it is, but it seems to be a lot that love it. How did you get started with D&D, and why did you use that as part of Duke Cannon, the Natural 20 character?
So I got into Dungeons & Dragons when I was still living back up north. There was a, you know, what our circle of friends were all into like really nerdy stuff. You know, at that point I was like still collecting like Warhammer, which I'm back on that addiction now, but I won't get started on that, otherwise we will be here for 4 hours.
You did threat. You'd be there. If you start speaking about it, you'd be here for 4 hours.
Yeah, I'm legitimate. I'm doing everyone a favor by not talking about it right now. But you know, we're into like a lot of geeky stuff, and we thought, you know, we're going to give it the proper try. And this was back when we were using 3.5 edition, which is a lot of fun, but it's quite scary for like newer players. Purely because like it's so math heavy, like there's you calculate every single thing, like the weight of each individual like nail and hammer that you have in your bag and things like that, and if you go one bit over you have to like do this equation to know how much, like how less strength you've got. It's ridiculous. They actually put that into an offshoot in its own called Pathfinder. Just because, you know, you got some people who are just like, but maybe I like doing maths in my spare time. Just like, well, go and do your fucking maths. The rest of us are going to have fun. But we did a bit of that. And when I moved down here, I really wanted to get back into it again. But I didn't have a lot of people who knew what, you know, who knew how to play it and stuff. So I remember getting one of the starter kits for the 5th edition. And I was like that to my flatmate at the time. I was like, okay, we're gonna play. Because like we talked about it for ages, of like, oh, I'd love to have a game, love to have a game. And I was like, right, we're doing this. So we sat down, and You know, I got to like rediscover my love for it. I was doing the Dungeon Master at the time, so it was really good to get to like take new people through the experience and like seeing how somebody who's like starting the game for the first time, seeing how they think about things and seeing how they sort of like go into situations. Like the guys that I were taking through, they didn't tend to do a lot of like combat stuff. Like if there was a combat situation, they would always try and see if they could talk the way out of it or maybe sneak out of it. And I'm the kind of dungeon master where I'm just like, you know what? Like, so long as you're not breaking the game, I will do, you know, I will allow anything. And it's, I think that's like the aspect that I like the most about it. It's that creative flourish. It's thinking about what your character would do and how they would react to certain situations. And I feel that I think that the reason that a lot of wrestlers are into it is because there is a lot of that crossover as well. When you're, you know, when I go out in the ring as Duke Cannon, it's different to who I am just as a sort of normal everyday person. You know, I'm going out there and I'm thinking as this character, I'm thinking about how would this person react to this? How would this person react to that? I've said to people, like, if you struggle with like doing promos or anything like that, or with like thinking up gimmick ideas, that Dungeons and Dragons is one of the best things that you can do to encourage that creativity. It's one of the best things that you can do to properly sort of start thinking in those kind of terms, especially if you're not really the kind of creative type. But I've kind of just had like a lifelong love of all of these kind of tabletop games as well. Like on my shelf, I've got a few other ones. I've got like Cyberpunk, I've got Mortborg. As I said, my crippling Warhammer addiction, where I've spent unholy amounts of money on just little men that I like to move millimeters across a table at a time for about 6 hours.
Better than spending loads of money on things that just stay up on the shelf here that just don't move. I mean, at least you get to play with them. I did Warhammer for about a week. It was when they did the Lord of the Rings sets. And then I really liked the chrome ones. I thought they were really cool. And then people were like, I should paint them. I'm like, no. I know my skill painting. That's not happening. So I like them chrome. They will stay chrome forever.
I've really got to blame Zach Leon for that one, because he started posting some of the pictures of the Warhammer he was painting, and I was like, you know what, I'll maybe just get like a little box of orcs and, you know, just something to pass the time, because, you know, it's the pandemic, there's nothing else going on, I can't really leave the house. And then before I knew it, I'm just in there anytime that I've got my paycheck just being like, give me my plastic crack now.
Yeah, again, same with this wall of crap in the corner. And then Christmas Day, I found out I was going to be a dad, and I was like, oh, well, that's the collection ruined then. I was just, you know, so I've got to buy baby stuff now. It's a shame. But, you know, still got my belt out. That'll stay out forever. It's never going, much to my wife's chagrin. She's looking at every time going, can you just put the belts away? No. You can put away the pops. I'm happy with that. The belt stays out forever.
It's a compromise. You have to do this in marriage.
Exactly. Although she met tonight, and this is, I was so happy. She went, oh, that room's just like your man cave, isn't it? It's like, challenge accepted. I'm going to put out my Captain America shield. That's going on the wall now, because you said it's my man cave. That's what I heard. I didn't hear it's like your. No, I heard it's my man cave. So it's all the stuff's going up now. I've got belt hangers. They're going up. She doesn't know this yet. So when it comes to this episode going out on April 15th, then I might be dead. So just because I've tried to screw in 3 wall hangers to put in some wrestling belts on the wall. So we took your Warhammer. Your D&D addiction to the natural 20. Was that just, you didn't see anyone else do that kind of character, and you thought, well, this is just like me turned up to 11. What was your, was that your kind of thought process? How did you get there?
I mean, there was a kind of element of you know, seeing that there was no one else sort of really doing that, kind of thing as well. And I think it is true what they say of like any wrestling gimmick is just yourself turned up to 11. And I incorporate like other aspects of myself. So I mean, it's why I've got like a, you know, like my entrance seems a little bit more sort of like rock and roll. I come up with the denim jacket and things. My initial idea was that I basically wanted to be like the cross between who your dad played D&D with in the 70s and the guy he bought weed off of in the 70s and kind of just mashed those guys together.
So I mean, all right, so the patches and all that, I'm looking at your promo picture because it helps me with these things. So yeah, play patches, is that another crippling addiction that you've now started because you have a denim jacket that you add patches to? Is it any band that you see you're like going patches and need to know if they've got patches so I can put them on my got any patches kind of thing going on as well?
Yeah, I mean, again, playing live music for so many years, and especially playing in the sort of like metal and punk scenes, you know, battle jackets have been a kind of a part of my aesthetic for quite a while. So I've always, you know, I mean, like when it came to like my entrance gear, I was like, this is a no-brainer. I'm gonna make like a cool battle jacket. I got like the sort of custom back logo as well that sort of says name, and happened to also manage to find a logo that, well, a patch that kind of fits the color scheme and the aesthetic and stuff that I could put in the middle, that'll look quite good. But yeah, I'm that kind of fiend as well. I go to concerts and like I'm always looking out for like a sick patch that I can put on a jacket. It's just a beeline to the merch stand and be like, ah, there we go, give me that one.
I know. I'm the kind that's got I've got a drawer full of patches of many places I've been, but I have no sewing skill to actually put them onto anything. So again, it's just a drawer full of stuff, which seems to be the story of this, especially this room's life. It's just, I've got drawers full of things that may go out one day. Who knows? That's just it. Have you ever thought, because you're doing the D&D, the Warhammer thing, it will be a bit of a mind fuck for people, but have you ever thought of like having like a hybrid kind of wrestling match where someone has to roll dice for you to do a move? Because you saw Gene Money did the Black Mirror kind of thing, Bander match, I think it was called.
Yeah.
So of course then the crowd decided or tweeted or decided what the next move was going to be. Have you ever put any thought into doing something like that, or if I just lit that fire and you're going to contact John as soon as we've finished up?
So I have had one idea, because we have floated the idea of maybe doing that where I'd love to make like a table of moves like numbered 1 to 20, get someone in the audience to like roll a dice, and whatever number hits, that's the move that I have to hit next. But I've also had the idea of like I have to, like, before I do a move, I roll the dice to see how well I do that move. If I get a one, I just have to just spike myself into the ground. Just be like, well, the dice has spoken, just bang.
Go, yeah, or even if you roll it, you go, oh, that's a one. I'm not going to do that. I'll think of something else. And just anything is, like wrestling's such a creative art form where we're saying the Bander match and like Orange Cassidy and stuff like that. Stuff like this works. Whether if you commit to it, which as we're going back to like passion and enjoying wrestling, if you commit to it, people will believe it and they'll just go, well, this is happening. Well, we'll just enjoy it as it happens for the next however long it is. At the same time. So yeah, there we go. That's the future. FCW or Press Start Gaming, if they ever do a wrestling show for one of their things. The I don't know what to call it. The D&D match. I don't know. I'm not. I come up with the ideas. People come up with the names. So that's fine.
Well, we can work on it. We can refine exactly. It.
Yeah. Well, think of it. It was one of those. They'll come to me in like 2 o'clock in the morning, and I'll message you or that, and you'll look and go, why has he just written this down? I don't know what's happening. But anyway, so we did get a question through Facebook. They'll ask my silly questions. Do some fantasy dream matches at the end, and we'll kind of close up, because I realized we're hit over an hour, and I don't know about you, but once it hits in the next 10 minutes, if I'm not starting to wind down, then I'll just fall asleep, because it's after 9 o'clock and I'm old. I'm only 1 year older than you, and that terrifies me that I'm just like going 9 o'clock, no, sleep.
I know, I'm the exact same. I'm the exact same. As soon as it hits anywhere about past 8:30, it's like, okay, this is winding down time.
Yeah,
like the amount of times that I get like invites to the pub and stuff, I'm just like, nah, I don't leave the house anymore. I just want to curl up and put something on Netflix. That's all I want to do.
That's it. It's like half 8 arrives, and the next show on Netflix that goes out, starting in 10 seconds, you need to go, can I commit to this? Can I commit to going past 9 o'clock just going past that threshold? Anyway, questions. We did Eddie Devine, Mighty Fine Eddie Devine himself. He asked, any fond memories involving a dragon sleeper?
I knew this. As soon as I heard that name, I knew this was coming up. Okay, so, right. There was one time at Company Name Redacted. We were doing some shoot wrestling as some conditioning. I've done like a little bit of like MMA stuff. I mean, nothing major. I could never go into the octagon. I'd just get my ass handed to me. I would say that I know enough to not completely lose a fight. I'm not like one of these like, I'm the tough guy, I'm the shoot style wrestler that does everything. I'm as soft as they come. But you know, we're doing like a little bit of shoot wrestling, me and Eddie in the ring, and there was one point that I managed to get him in a dragon sleeper, and I'm going down to the ground and I'm like, okay, all I've got to do is lock my legs round his waist and you know, it's fine, I've got him here. This motherfucker decides to do the one thing I never thought anyone would do and backflip over my shoulder. Like, literally, I've got him here, and he was just like, wham! And, like, he's midair, and I'm just like, you cheeky bastard! I wasn't even angry, I was impressed. And, like, every single person in the room was just like, did that just happen? And we suddenly just got, like, a crowd of people around the ring. As I'm trying my best not to laugh and lose this shoot match, because I'm just so astounded that, like, he pulls out. It makes me think of, like, the art of war of, like, know your enemy, and it was almost like that. It's just, like, pulling out something completely out of the bag that I was just unprepared for, and it was such a beautiful experience. Again, that's a guy that I love to no end as well, Eddie Devine. I know you're gonna be watching this, Eddie. How's it going? But yeah, that's I think the funniest thing is, like, a week later we were putting a match together, we're working, and we thought, oh, we're gonna work the spot again. So I thought, oh yeah, we'll do the backflip spot and all that, but we couldn't do it. Like, we couldn't do it when we tried to work it. I think it was just like a weird fight or flight response that he had. It was just like, I'm just going to backflip up over your shoulder. Because even at the end of it, he came up to me and was just like, I didn't know I could do that.
And never again. It was done. Never again done.
It was a lightning in a bottle, man. It was such a beautiful moment.
So that seems like a nice little question to start winding down. Like we say, we're both wanting to get to bed, obviously our own beds. So we ask people on this podcast two ridiculous questions that people seem to really enjoy answering. They take it far more seriously than I ever expect them to. First one being, what's your favorite dinosaur? I'm assuming it's a question you've been asked many times because it's Kevin Williamson who sent this question way back when. So assuming you've already been asked this.
Yeah, and I always say I'm going to come back to that, and I'm not going to lie, I knew this question was coming up, and I've been thinking really hard of just like, what do I say, what's my reasoning for it. I think my favorite is, and it's for the weirdest reason, I've always been a big fan of the Land Before Time movies. I watched them growing up, absolutely loved them. And Littlefoot was just, he was just so adorable. I still think he's adorable. So like brontosauruses are my favorite dinosaurs for that reason. It's just anytime that I see like a picture of that. I think it's also like that bit in Jurassic Park as well, when you first see, you know, when you first get the reveal of the dinosaurs, and it's just these huge brontosauruses that are just like, you know, they're just grazing and things like that, and the look on their face, which was the exact same look that I had when I was a child, seeing what I thought was pretty much actual dinosaurs on screen.
Fair enough. I like when people think outside the box and don't just go for a dinosaur. You go for Littlefoot, cartoon, Just a character. That's always the best way to go. The other question we ask everyone is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow? See, this is a question. I think it's the most ridiculous question, and yet everyone has a really long think about it. And I'm like,
how cohesive a unit are the sheep? Like, have they been tagging for a while? They've worked out each other.
Now, this is the annoying part. That's the question. I have no further information for you. You're gonna have to use the rest. You're gonna have to use your imagination. Some people have went, if it's a Highland cow, they've decided it's a Highland cow, then so that it's definitely winning because it's got horns and all that kind of stuff. Some people have decided that the two sheep are like massive sheep or they're just lambs. It's your imagination that rules this question.
Well, I would say that probably as, you know, as somebody who like grew up in the countryside and has been chased by cows, I think I'm more scared of a cow than I am sheep. So even with like the greater numbers, I think the cow would probably take the win.
Fair enough. That's fine. There's no wrong answers here. Even though I still think the sheep's going to win, but you know, it's your imagination at the end of the day that rules that question. Like I said, I still can't believe I got told off by Joe Henry by having such a vague question. That's a weird way of life. By having it like, no, there's too many variables. Like, Joe, this is the question. I have nothing else for you. So answer it. So that's our silliness that we have. So we'll move on to like some, like say, fantasy booking, because you're still early in your career, even though you had that big 18-month gap of nothing because of you know, coronavirus and all that fun stuff, which touch wood, at this point, I still have yet to get it. So I'm guaranteeing I've now jinxed that, and when this episode comes out, I will be like on my deathbed, cursing my own stupidity for saying that. But no, I don't leave the house. That's why I hate outside.
I feel that so much. That was the one thing, like when I quit working at Tesco's call centers, that I didn't get to work from home anymore. I was just like, oh, I've got to like go out and interact with people now. This is horrible.
I know there's rumblings and rumors are that my work, they're going to start phasing people back into the office, and I'm like, no, please don't. I like it here. I'm surrounded by my stuff.
Rather than being surrounded by co-workers that I just don't care about.
Exactly. They're going to ask me things like, what are you having for tea? Like, I don't know. Okay, leave me alone. Just try to get through the day. Anyway, yeah. So quite early on, so we've had a few matches. So there's still many, many opponents just in like Fear City Wrestling and Arcadian and all that you want to get in the ring with. But who's like on your list? Who's on your short list of folk that you want to get in the ring with as soon as possible?
Let's think. So if we're talking people on the sort of more people in Scotland or people in even just the UK, I would love to get in a chance in the ring with Sebastian Asher. Again, he's one of my friends. We've known each other since Name Redacted, and he is honestly a goddamn workhorse. I've seen him just go from strength to strength, and I think we could have just a fantastic match. I'd like to have a proper match with Bochico as well, because he's just, I can sit and just watch him wrestle all day, and I'm always just thinking, just like, I want to be in there. I want to be in there working with them. I'd love to get back in the ring at some point with Foundation of the Future as well, because that, again, that was just a fantastic match. Same with Biggs as well. That was just utterly fantastic. In terms of some of the people that I, in FCW that I don't really know yet, I would really like to have a match against Caleb Valhalla. Again, watching him in the ring is just always fantastic. As soon as he comes out, as soon as I hear that entrance theme, it's just a scroll. I'm just hyped as anything. Looking sharp as well. We had a seminar with him, as well as like his own seminars he'd been doing on the dojo. He came to the SCW training school, talked to us a lot about like his character work and things like that. And I think we could probably bounce off each other quite well. I'd love an opportunity for that. I'd also love to have a match against like Brody Adler and Aisha Raymond as well, if we ever sort of got them over. You know, I'm all about like just wrestling everyone and anyone. Yeah, you know, I'm like, divisions be damned. These hands are rated E for everyone.
And as far as companies then, so of course FCW Arcadian, that's your kind of your Arcadian's your home away from home kind of thing. Is there any companies in Scotland, UK, or Europe even that you're wanting to you would love to try and get to?
Oh, there's a few. I'd love to. I mean, just in Scotland alone, you have something like Disco and WrestleZone. I mean, I'd like to work WrestleZone because, like, being from Aberdeenshire and having like a lot of friends up in Aberdeen as well, you know, I'd love to sort of work in front of an Aberdeen crowd. I'd love to work for Disco. Everything that I've seen that's came out of there has just been utterly fantastic as well. In terms of like maybe down in England, I mean, the big one, you know, probably something like Progress, that would be quite cool, or Wrestle Carnival, I think would be a lot of fun as well. If I could get a chance to go and work for OTT over in Ireland as well, again, that would be utterly fantastic, getting to be in front of, again, a completely fresh audience. That would be just utterly amazing for me. If anything, I'm very much kind of like an easy Aussie guy. I like wrestling. I just really enjoy it. So, I mean, even if I was working in just a tiny town hall with like 10 people there, I'd go out and I'd just have as much fun with it as possible. I mean, I've done that with gigs. I've literally played gigs where there's been like one person in the room. But whenever an opportunity arises like that, you play it as if it's like Wembley Stadium. You go out, you put in 100%, because that one person who's came in is a person who's paid for a ticket and has decided that this is how they want to spend their time. So you give them what they have paid for. And I'd like to think that I'd carry that exact same mentality over into wrestling as well. So, I mean, for me, it's a case of like, if anybody wants to book me, just give me a call. I'm an open book, so long as I can actually get the time in between the 50 million other things that I do in my spare time.
Do you ever get to any of the WrestleZone shows when you're up there, up in the Northeast? Like they did, I think they did McDuff a couple of times, and that.
I did go to there was a McDuff one, and I think that was about maybe, I think it must have been about like 2010 or 2011 ish, because I always remember one of my mates, a guy called Craig, who I went to school with, he turned up and he was quite drunk. At least I assume he was drunk by his next actions, because I remember Crusher Craig coming out and my mate Craig just standing there going like, I want some Crusher, give me some Crusher, for about 15 minutes solid. I'm just sitting there just being like, dude, he's probably not going to be too happy at that. Although I think also there was, I think on that show there was a wrestler who was named, I'm pretty sure that was when they brought up El Ligero as well. A real sort of like name. I mean, nowadays, I mean, at the time, you know, we don't know these things. Hindsight's 2020.
No.
But yeah, so I mean, like, I remember, I think that was about 2010 or 2011, unless I'm like combining two shows together. I've got like the most terrible memory, but I do remember going to one of the WrestleZone shows because it was at the McDuff Town Hall, the one just down by the harbour. Because I always remember, because like they've got like these high windows, but there's also a way to sneak up to those windows. So the amount of people who would just like sneak up to the windows and just look in, and they didn't have any curtains or anything, so I think like the hall was like, it wasn't like empty, but I think there was more people, like more of the kids just crowding around the windows than there were like sort of paying for tickets, unfortunately.
Well, let's just hope next time you see, when you're wrestling up in WrestleZone, you see Crusher, that you're not just looking at him going, Crusher, give me some Crusher.
Like I think that if I do that, he might think it was me that did it and then just punch me in the face. So I'll just be like, I swear it wasn't me. I swear to God.
Let's wrap up then with the final question, which is before we do social media stuff, is like a fancy question. You get to pick, you're in the main event of your favored big show, whether it's Wrestle Kingdom, WrestleMania, whatever AEW's is, All In, All Out, I'll Shake It All About, I don't know. You get to pick the main event. You can pick your opponent or opponents, match type, everything. Who would it be? So it could be anyone that's, I would say alive would be good, because it would be a bit weird otherwise, but anyone at all, who would it be?
Oh, that's a tough one. I would probably pick, because I am, just because I'm a big fan of them at the moment, my opponent that I would pick is, I would love to work with Warhorse. Ever since I saw him, I just gravitated. I was just like, this is a guy. I kind of liked him in the same way of like sort of Dan Housen and Orange Cassidy, just somebody who was coming out and doing something wholly unique, had a proper full character, sort of fully formed, straight out the back, coming out and just sort of just warming the crowd with his character work. I feel that we could probably bounce off each other quite well if I ever got the opportunity. So I'd probably pick him as the opponent. For the show, Let's go for the big spot. Let's go for the Night of the Immortals itself, right? WrestleMania. So it's me and Warhorse at WrestleMania, and match stipulation. You know, again, I'd probably have to go for something a little bit all out. I'd probably go for something like a TLC match, like, you know, go big or go home. Like, bring out, you know, all the bells and whistles and try not to die in the process.
I know, if you've got the opportunity, you may as well do everything you can. I'm still waiting for someone to go out Kennel from Hell, because, you know, Kennel from Hell was amazing, and it could have been if they do it again one day. Thank you very much for joining me today. Where can people find Duke Cannon on social media?
So you can find me on Twitter at Natural Duke. You can also find me on Facebook if you just look up Duke Cannon, and you'll see this lovely face as the profile picture. And you know, give us a like, give us a subscribe, or whatever the kids are saying, or even just give me a message if you ever, you know, if you fancy knowing it, like, want to know anything about me.
Then send in pictures of Warhammer that you've painted, you know.
Oh yeah, I will. That is a fair warning. If you send me a message, I will just show you. Just like, look at these things. Actually, screw it, I'm going to do this one as well.
Good for the video okay. Content. If people that listen to audio, they will lose all this.
So here, yeah, if you're listening to the podcast, you're missing out on some prime Warhammering as I'm showing off this little shaman.
Yeah, I always love the painted on and everything. I love the look of them, but yeah.
I knew I was going to descend into this. I knew instantly I was going to...
But no, we'll wrap up there while we can get out. No, unless you've got a story to tell to close out.
I'm trying to think if there's anything I can sign off on. And no, I mean, that's basically been my sort of my wrestling life so far. But here's to some many more fantastic opportunities. Here's to some more, many more years of this wrestling journey that I'm on, and see where everything goes. So again, thank you so much for inviting me on here. I've had a blast. And just have to see what the future holds.
So send Duke Warhammer pictures, and we'll close out with that. Thank you very much for joining me.